If we do not activate that creative power, we will continue to be barren as Sarah was in producing a baby. In Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25, there is an incredible passage. I learned it many years ago, not because I tried to memorize it, but just because of usage, because it's so crucial in order for us to understand what God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit have accomplished through Jesus on this earth. Hebrews 7, 25. Therefore, he is able to save, some versions say, completely to the uttermost, forever, all those that draw near to God through him. For he ever lives to make intercession for them.
Amen.
Some people have been taught that Jesus is standing between you and God because God wants to zap you. Since your choices made it necessary for Jesus to come and die on the cross. I believed that for years. Well, I'm glad that Jesus is between me and God because I know God is ready to, you know, burn me. But if you look up the word intercede in the Hebrew 7:25, it is Jesus that is interceding to each one of you personally to recognize what he has accomplished for you. He wants for you to have complete and direct access to God, but it must come through him first. God is not trying to eliminate us because of our choices in the past. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit have created something, invented something, if you will. Something very, very special. It's called the faith of Jesus.
Amen.
Let's take a look at how that was created. If you are a creative person, I want to urge you to go ahead with your creative talent. There's just two things I don't want for you to invent. Just two. That leaves you many other things you can invent. The first thing I don't want for you to invent is the wheel. Because that's been invented. In fact, most of you came here this morning in a vehicle that had four wheels attached to it. So don't invent the wheel. It's been done. The other thing I don't want for you to invent is the faith of Jesus. Jesus has invented it. And he gives it to each one of us that is willing to what? Accept it as subjective faith. Because that is the creative power of God in Jesus' faith. Let's take a look at a couple of scriptures. How are we doing on time? So far, okay. Let's take a look at Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3. Someone asked me once, what do you think of the book of Galatians? I said, well, it really applies to me. And he said, what do you mean it applies to you? He said, well, I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. Really? What's so special about the book of Galatians and Seventh-day Adventist? And I said, because the book of Galatians, as I understand it, was only written to two groups of people. The six churches in southern Turkey that Paul raised and the Seventh-day Adventist church. Because these two groups of people are the only ones that are trying to make it through heaven through works. Galatians 3, verse 23. Are you there? Galatians 3, 23. But before, your Bibles say the next word is, after before is faith. But in the original language, you have the definite article, T-H-E, the. Before the faith came, we were kept in custody under the law, being shut up to, now is correctly translated, to what? The faith. which was later to be revealed. 24. Therefore, the law has become our tutor to lead us to whom?
Christ.
Christ. That we may be justified by how?
Faith.
Subject to faith. Verse 25. But now that, here we go again, the faith, and you should mark this in your Bible so that you know what it's talking about. It's not talking about faith. It's talking about the faith. Whose faith? The faith of Jesus. That's what I've been asked to share with you this morning. The faith of Jesus. But now that the faith has come, we are no longer under a tutor. 26. For you are all sons of God through the faith in Christ Jesus. Do you like that? This is beautiful. And once you understand it, you're no longer going to be focusing on terrific you. You're going to be focusing on terrific Jesus, who invented the faith. The faith of Jesus. Now let's turn to Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. This is a passage that all of you know by memory. Romans chapter 12, beginning with verse 1. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is the least that you can possibly do. Why? Because Jesus has invented faith. And all he's asking you to do is, would you please accept this free gift? My faith. Now, what? Why is he asking you to do that? Look at verse 2. So that you not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your works. Is that correct?
No.
The renewing of your mind. The word mind, they're speaking of your attitude. What is your attitude? Is your attitude, you're worried whether you're going to make it to heaven or not? Anyone that's worried whether they're going to make it to heaven or not is focused on objective faith rather than subjective faith. That ye may prove what is a good and acceptable, perfect will of God. What is the will of God? Look at the last part of verse 3. For through the grace given to me, I say to every man among you, not to think more highly of himself than he ought to think, but to think so as to have sound judgment, as God has allowed it to each a measure of faith. It's for you to decide whether that becomes objective or subjective. What does that mean? How many of you have a cell phone? How many of you have a smartphone, intelligent phone, brilliant phone, iPhone? All you have to do is plug in to heaven. When you submit a prayer to Jesus, where do you send it? Jesus? General delivery? Heaven? No. We're talking about subjective faith. Subjective faith only mails their prayers to mediatorial high priest. Address. Second apartment. Not first apartment, but second apartment. Where? Sanctuary. And what is the zip code? The faith of Jesus. If you don't get the zip code right, final exam. How many of you went to school, high school or college, and you took a course when on the final day the professor said, here's your test, here's the only question on the test, and here's the answer to that? Did I hear an eyewitness? Me too. In closing, let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 13. 2 Corinthians chapter 13. It's the last chapter, 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 13. And here's our test. This determines whether you're going to be in heaven or not. But more importantly, this determines if you participate during every waking moment of each day in identifying with what heaven is focused on. One writer said, it is our privilege to spend the waking moments of each day in Jesus' private office. Do you like that?
Amen.
This is what we're studying this morning. If you allow faith, the faith, to become subjective faith in you, and that is each of our choice. Look at the test question and the answer to the test question. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5. Test yourselves. If you are where? In the faith. Examine yourselves. Or do you not recognize this about yourselves? That Jesus Christ is in you, unless indeed you fail the test. So if you want Christ in you, the hope of glory, you have to decide what you're going to do with the faith. And you can choose to just let it remain objective faith and wallow in all these facts about the Bible. Or you can choose to make it subjective faith. And then Jesus guarantees that he comes in and he takes over.
Amen.
And the reason that is the only solution is because what God inspired Jeremiah to say in Jeremiah 17:9, the heart is a deceitful thing and desperately incurable. That's what the Hebrew says. There is no cure for our sinful hearts. In the New Testament, Paul says in Romans 8:7, the carnal mind is enmity against God. You know what the word enmity means? It's at war. The carnal mind is at enmity with God and not subject to the law of God, and neither can it be, even if it tries. So what do we need? We need the faith of Jesus, not just in objective facts, but in subjective experience. And it is my prayer this morning that that is the choice that each of you will make. And that is not to resist the advances of the Holy Spirit that wants to come in and indwell you with the faith of Jesus. And you can experience subjective faith the rest of your life. God bless you. Our closing hymn is number 191.
I'd like to remind anyone that if they would like to get a material from the library on the subject of faith, come in after the service.
Thank you.
We pray that we will understand very clearly that all of the things that we know from Scripture must become a subjective reality in our lives. Help us to recognize that heaven gave all and solved every possible situation that we individually can possibly face on this earth. Help us to grasp that by faith, the faith of Jesus, so that it will become subjective faith in our lives. And you can use us to bring anyone into our lives, and we will know that we will be used as a reliable and complete witness for you. Go with us as we go our separate ways, watch over us, and as we continue to interact this afternoon, may the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart be acceptable in your sight. We ask this and thank you for answering it in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.